This is Leonard Bernstein, and I'm going to tell you the story of Peter and the Wolf. Now, usually before this piece begins, the speaker explains how each person or animal in the story is described by a certain instrument of the orchestra. But I'm sure you know all that already, don't you? Well, all right, let's see if you do. For instance, who's being represented by these three French horns? Right, the wolf. And what is this oboe describing? Right again, the duck. And now the flute? You're batting 1,000, the bird. Now, who's this low character in the clarinet? Right, the cat. Then, of course, there are these well-known drum beats. What's that all about? Correct, the hunters shooting their guns. Now, who is this lumbering old bassoon? Grandfather. My, you really know this piece, don't you? Well, that's all of them. Except, wait, I left out the most important one of all, the strings. And that is Peter himself. I congratulate you on a perfect quiz. And now the story begins. Early one morning, Peter opened the gate and went into the big green meadow next to his house. The first friend he met was a little bird sitting on the branch of a big tree. The bird was chirping away happily, "All is quiet, all is quiet, all is quiet, all is quiet." Yes, all was quiet. Even the pond was still, because there wasn't a breath of wind to ruffle it. Soon a duck came waddling around. She lived in Peter's backyard, and she was glad that Peter had forgotten to close the gate, because now she could take a nice swim in the deep, still pond that was in the middle of the meadow. The little bird spied the duck and flew down next to her on the grass. "Huh," said the bird, "what kind of a bird are you if you can't fly?" "Huh," answered the duck, "what kind of a bird are you if you can't swim?" And she dived into the pond. They argued and argued, the duck swimming around the pond and the little bird hopping after her along the shore. All of a sudden, something else caught Peter's attention. There was a cat sneaking through the grass. The cat thought, while the bird is busy arguing with the duck, I'll just grab him. And she slowly crept towards the bird on her velvet paws. "Look out!" yelled Peter to the bird, who immediately flew up into the tree. While the duck swam as fast as she could to the middle of the pond where the cat couldn't touch her, and quacked at the cat with all her might. But the cat was more interested in the bird. She crawled round the tree and thought, "Is it worth climbing up so high? By the time I get there, the bird will have flown away." While Peter was watching the cat make up her mind, he suddenly saw his grandfather standing at the open gate. Grandfather was very angry because Peter had gone out into the meadow. "This is a dangerous place," he growled. "Suppose a wolf came out of the forest, then what would you do?" Peter paid no attention to his grandfather's words because boys like Peter aren't afraid of wolves. Grandfather took Peter firmly by the hand, led him home, and locked the gate. Sooner had Peter gone than a big gray wolf did come out of the forest. In a flash, the cat scampered up the tree. Duck's quacking became even louder than before, and in her excitement, she jumped right out of the pond. But no matter how fast the duck tried to waddle away, she couldn't escape the wolf. He was getting nearer and nearer, catching up with her. And bang, he got her, and with one gulp, he swallowed her. Now, this is how the situation was. The cat was sitting on one branch of the big tree. And the bird on another branch. Not too close to the cat. And the wolf, still hungry, was walking around and around the tree, looking at them both with greedy eyes. Thank you. the meantime, Peter, not at all scared by any of this, was standing behind the closed gate, watching everything that was going on. Suddenly, he got a brilliant idea. He ran home, found a strong rope, and climbed up the high stone wall that separated his house from the meadow. You see, the big tree in the meadow was so big that one of its branches reached all the way over to the wall. So Peter grabbed hold of the branch and swung himself easily over onto the tree, right next to the bird. "Listen," he whispered to the bird. "Fly down and circle around the wolf's head. Only watch out he doesn't catch you." "Just as you say," chirped the bird, and down he flew. The bird came so close to the wolf's head that he almost brushed it with his wings, while the wolf snapped angrily at him from every direction. How the bird did tease that wolf, and how the wolf wanted to catch that bird. But the bird was cleverer, and the wolf simply couldn't do a thing about it. Meanwhile, Peter had been making a lasso out of the rope, and now he carefully began letting it down, and down, and down, until he caught the wolf by the tail and pulled with all his might. The moment the wolf felt his tail caught in the lasso, he became furious and began to jump about wildly, trying to get loose. Peter tied the other end of the rope to the branch. And so the wolf's jumping only made the rope around his tail tighter. Just then, Peter saw some hunters coming out of the woods. They had been following the wolf's trail, and they were shooting as they came. Thank you. Peter, high up in the tree, shouted to the hunters, "Don't shoot! The bird and I have already caught the wolf. All you have to do is help us take him to the zoo." There's the story. And now... just imagine the victory parade. Peter, of course, in the lead. Following Peter, the hunters leading the wolf. Winding up the whole parade, Grandfather and the cat. Grandfather, of course, was pretty grumpy about the whole thing. "Well," he said, "and what if Peter hadn't caught the wolf? What then?" Above them all flew the little bird, chirping merrily, "My, what fine fellows we are, Peter and I. Look what we have caught, a whole wolf." Listen very carefully, you can still hear the duck quacking, very softly, of course, inside the wolf's belly. Because the wolf, in all his excitement and hurry, swallowed her alive.